And I'm thrilled today to be joined by three heroic executive directors of our programs here in Illinois. Kate Shank, the executive director of Legal Aid Chicago, centered here in obviously Chicago. Denise Conklin from Prairie State Legal Services, whose main office is in Rockford. And Clarissa Gaff from Land of Lincoln Legal Aid, whose main office is in East St. Louis. Let's give them a round of applause. Together, Clarissa, Kate, and Denise and their colleagues represent the three grantees that served over 63,000 Illinois residents annually, including over 1,400 veterans, over 6,000 seniors, and over 5,000 survivors of domestic violence. They're here today to help us understand the true impact of these numbers, the stories like the one we just heard, and the ways in which legal aid impacts people's lives from the time they're young all the way through their senior years. Welcome. We'd like to hear each of you talk briefly about your programs. Kate, let's start with you.
Great. Thank you so much, Ron. I'm Kate Shank. I'm the CEO of Legal Aid Chicago. And I am so grateful to be here. I'm just so proud of the tremendous work of LSC over the last 50 years to really firm up and establish and support legal aid across this country. I'm thankful for all of you, the time that you are spending here today and your support of civil legal aid, and of course, of my two fellow programs and my colleagues that are here, thank you. So Legal Aid Chicago is the LSC-funded organization. We serve Cook County, so that means the city of Chicago and the surrounding suburbs, and we provide some of our services statewide. There are about a million people who are financially eligible for our services in our service area. So to talk about financial eligibility, just very briefly, what that means is that a family of four can, generally speaking, not earn more than $39,000 a year and remain eligible for our services. And we know that even for middle-income families, the cost of legal representation is challenging. But for low-income families, it is frankly out of reach. They will be alone, protecting their personal safety, protecting their housing, their jobs, their children's education, unless they have a civil legal aid attorney standing next to them. We do not charge for our services ever, and that is thanks to the support from LSC, thanks to government and foundation grants, to our law firms and corporate sponsors, and to our individual donors. Real briefly about our clients. Legal Aid Chicago, about 85% or so of our clients are people of color. Two-thirds are women, and about a third are people living with disabilities. We cover the full range of civil legal aid issues, which you've heard a little bit about today, and we're going to have the chance to speak on in a little bit more depth on many more this afternoon. But we get the most number of calls, as was mentioned earlier, on issues related to housing and to family law, particularly domestic violence. But really, for all of the legal issues where we handle, there is a huge need for our services. We are located physically about 2 miles from here. That's our main office, but we do have outposts in the form of help desks and clinics all around the city and county. We have about 220 full-time staff, 115 attorneys, 60 paralegals, and then 15 other intake and social work folks, all of whom work to provide direct representation, to provide brief services and advice to our clients. Our work every year for our clients and their family members who live with them impacts around 24,000 people. Though we provide a lot of short-term service for our clients, so the advice, the letters, the phone calls, where we really spend our time is in direct representation on complicated matters that require an attorney to appear in court or an administrative proceeding, both in our local courts, but also in appellate and federal courts as well.
Clarissa?
Good afternoon, I'm Clarissa Gaff, and I want to thank you all for being here, and I want to thank John and Ron for inviting me to participate. We've really enjoyed LSC support for the past 5 decades for our work, and we couldn't begin to serve the numbers of people that we do without LSC's support. So thank you very, very much. We're just very grateful. Land of Lincoln Legal Aid serves 65 counties in Illinois. That's the lower two-thirds of the state. The area is pretty large. It's about the size of Indiana. And we serve a variety of geographic regions, right? We serve urban populations in Champaign and our state capital of Springfield, but we also serve counties where deer outnumber the people. We have a staff of about 150. 75 of those folks are attorneys, 12 of those are social workers, and the rest are our support staff, all dedicated to serving individuals. We serve folks through 5 regional offices, 4 satellite offices, a legal advice and referral center, and then we're embedded in a number of places in our communities, including hospitals, doctor's offices, and schools. About 740,000 people are eligible for our services in those 65 counties, and we're only able to help about 13,000 folks annually with their civil legal problems. So it's a drop in the bucket, and we are rationing our services, right? We do a merit screening to determine whether someone's going to get advice and a brief service, or if they're going to get full representation. And as Kate mentioned, a complex matter where an attorney can really make the difference. 70% of our clients are women, and about a third as well have disabilities. Our top areas of requests for help are much like Kate's in the eviction arena and in family law, particularly for domestic violence survivors. I'm going to turn it over to Denise so she can share a little bit more about Prairie State.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Denise Conklin. I'm the executive director at Prairie State Legal Services. Thank you to Ron. Thank you to LSC broadly and the board. Thank you to my board members who are here. And thank you to all of you for your interest in this really important issue. So as with my colleagues, Prairie State Legal Services is an LSC-funded legal aid organization. We cover 36 counties in Illinois. So between our 3 organizations, we have Illinois covered with LSC's support. Our counties at Prairie State cover northern Illinois outside of Chicago and central Illinois, bordering in the Peoria, Bloomington, Kankakee area. So in those 36 counties, we have 11 local offices. We are, as my colleagues, committed to being in our communities so that we can respond to the community needs as they grow and change and have different focus. For our shop, we handled approximately 16,000 cases last year, and nearly half of them were housing, so that is continuing to be a repeated theme in our communities. Approximately half of our clients are people of color, and in our service area, about 228,000 households are at the very extreme poverty level. And we unfortunately do not have all the resources to meet those needs, but we try. And we'll talk a little bit about the volunteer program that we use to try to multiply that effect, thanks to LSC, as we've heard about earlier. Our clients include children who are being wrongfully denied school services. They are families who are surviving domestic violence, and they are veterans who are trying to access public benefits that they are eligible for but are meeting a barrier, and we'll go into those cases in more detail during this panel. Our 3 pillars at Prairie State, the way we describe them, are safety, housing, and financial stability. And financial stability includes that access to needed public benefits as well as access to jobs, ready-to-work programs to help people move from poverty into sustainable jobs. Thank you for this opportunity to share, and I look forward to this panel discussion.
So we're in just a few minutes going to go through the entire lifetime of people living in poverty in Illinois and see how our colleagues here help them through every phase of life. Let's turn first to child advocacy work. What does it look like from your team's perspectives to work with Illinois' youngest residents, Denise?
Thanks, Ron. So child advocacy, very important area that we all serve. So child advocacy work really is to help the kiddos, the children in our service area for relating to civil legal needs. The child advocacy work that I'm going to highlight here does highlight a partnership between our volunteer attorney program, our pro bono program, and our Prairie State staff attorneys. And the legal issue I'd like to highlight in this story is child abuse. So in the particular story I'd like to share with you, there are three little girls involved. And at the age that this started, they were 4, 3, and just an infant. And they were sisters living with their mom. And their father was, unfortunately, extremely abusive. And this all came to a head in an ER visit when one of the children had a fractured skull. Illinois' DCFS, Department of Children and Family Services, became involved, removed the three girls, and placed them with their maternal grandparents. And that's about when Prairie State got involved, but not quite yet. The grandparents started caring for the girls, but the father would not stop the abuse, and the harassments and the threats to the children and to the grandparents began. The grandparents called the police, and the police directed the grandparents to get an order of protection and then call Prairie State. Prairie State attorneys became involved and represented the children in an order of protection along with the grandparents. It was a long, challenging, contested hearing process, but the judge granted a 2-year plenary order of protection to protect the children from their father and also protect the grandparents. And that was great. That was a good, safe space to be in, but the grandparents started talking about a permanent solution for those children and whether adoption should be something that they looked into to become the legal parents of those three little girls. And Prairie State walked that journey with the grandparents in thinking that through and partnered with a local attorney who specialized in adoption law and referred the grandparents to that pro bono attorney to provide free legal services under LSC's pro bono program with Prairie State and was successful in a pretty straightforward adoption. And now those grandparents are the legal parents of those three little girls living in safety. So child abuse is just one area of child advocacy that our different legal aid organizations focus. But we also focus our child advocacy work on education law. That is where children in this country are entitled to a free, appropriate public education. And that is something we do at Prairie State, but I'm going to turn it over to my colleague here, Kate, and she will share more about that important area of our work.
Thanks, Denise. So our representation for kids in special in education matters focuses on special education and school discipline. So special education is support for children who have disabilities to make sure that they receive the school services and the school support that they're entitled to receive under the law that Denise mentioned. In school discipline matters, we represent children who are being pushed out of school due to a disciplinary issue. It is well documented that children of color and children with disabilities are far more likely to face these types of school pushouts, and those are typically the types of students, children, that we are representing. Legal Aid Chicago is really fortunate to have a contract to allow us to represent youth in foster care in their education-related needs. And through our three partnership here, we are allowed and are able to serve youth in foster care throughout the entire state. So through this special contract, we are not only advocating in an area that has a huge influence over a child's life, but really for children who are very, very particularly vulnerable. So children who are living in foster care are incredibly mobile. They move homes, they move schools far more often than a typical child. They also have a lot worse educational outcomes. They are more likely to be suspended and expelled. They are more likely to repeat a grade, and they are less likely to graduate from high school. They also have really high levels of trauma that follow them into the classroom. And these create such significant vulnerabilities that Illinois' Child Protective Services, the Department of Children and Family Services, recognized that they need special care and sought us out to provide that legal representation for those children. So one of our clients, I'm going to call her Madison, is a real example of how special education and school discipline collide. So Madison is a seventh grader, and she had recently entered the foster care system when she became our client. She had several mental health diagnoses, and she was getting therapy outside of school for those for that situation. The school knew about this, but the school did not assess her for any school-related care. So Madison had a history, she's a seventh grader, remind. She had a history of drinking in order to self-numb. And one day she brought a water bottle with alcohol and juice to school. And when she offered it to another student, the school found out and confronted her about it. And her reaction as a 12-year-old was fight or flight, and she ran from school. Now, instead of looking at this child and determining this child needs extra help and support, the school instead moved to expel her. And by expelling her, what that really means, and this is where it gets very bad, it means that this child and any other child that is expelled no longer has a right to return to any public school in Illinois for up to 2 years. So she could have been out of school for a significant period of time at such a really young age. So we represented Madison both before the school board and then before the Illinois State Board of Education by filing an administrative due process case. The school board moved forward with their decision to expel her. But they said, it's okay, we'll put her in an alternative school. But this is not a solution that would have resulted in any real education for Madison because, as I said, she could have easily moved school districts due to foster care placements, and the next school would not have had to take her. And an alternative school just is not the right level of education. It wouldn't have provided Madison the services that she needed. There's very, you know, there's limited course offerings. There are no extracurricular activities, and there's very minimal college and career counseling offered at that school. What we did is we were able to successfully advocate for her ultimately for the school district to determine that she needed special education services. She was entitled to them due to her disability, so we got her an IEP. We were able to prove that the school should have evaluated her for those services, and if they had done that, she probably wouldn't have been in the situation in the first place, or at the bare minimum, they would have not expelled her due to a reason that was quite clearly connected to her disability. So ultimately, we got her that IEP. We were able for the school to take the expulsion off of her record, and she was able to continue in her schooling. LSC funds also allow us to expand our representation of youth and education matters beyond kids in foster care. So in our region, there is just a real dearth of free legal aid to unschool discipline issues, which are very, very complicated. Even well-resourced parents find it impossible to navigate the system without representation. So we are one of the few legal aid organizations that is doing this work. And we are also, through the help of LSC, able to represent students who have been abused, in sexually harassed and abused in schools, which is another area that's greatly lacking in representation. And again, LSC funds have been critical. So I'd like to now turn it over to Clarissa, please, who's going to continue and share an example of their representation of a child with disabilities.
Yeah, so I'm going to share a little bit more about how we work in the education context to ensure that children who are our most vulnerable citizens really get the education they're entitled to. One individual we helped, she's a 13-year-old girl who I'm going to call Brianna. Brianna was living with her parents and her siblings when at age 4, she was diagnosed with lead poisoning. And unfortunately, her parents abused drugs and her family was often homeless. By the time we met with Brianna at age 13, she had moved over 20 times in the past 4 years. She had bounced between many schools, and she was living in foster care. She was chronically absent. Unfortunately, she missed 15 to 20% of all school days in each school year for 4 years. Brianna, at one point, had actually been diagnosed with a learning disability, but she was found ineligible for support for that disability because of her chronic absenteeism. She'd also been held back 4 times. So by the time we met Brianna, she was in fourth grade, but she should have been in seventh grade. Try to picture a 13-year-old in a fourth grader's desk. Think about how much bigger she is than her peers. And that was Brianna. Despite her diagnosed disabilities, Brianna didn't have an individualized education plan, an IEP, even though she was entitled to one to ensure her success in school. And her family recognized that something wasn't right, that she shouldn't be in fourth grade, and so they actually reached out to DCFS, who put her in contact with Land of Lincoln Legal Aid. After we had worked with Brianna and her guardian for a while, we filed a request with the Board of Education asking for a hearing. Through this resolution process at the Board of Education, we did reach an agreement. Brianna was assessed immediately and offered an individualized education plan that she should have had. More importantly, Brianna received compensatory education. And what that really meant was, beyond the regular school day, Brianna got 3 hours of work with a special education tutor every day after school for dozens of weeks. She received individual special education instruction for an entire summer. She received weekly counseling and tutoring. So as a result, when the next school year came around, Brianna was enrolled in eighth grade with the supports and accommodations she needed to flourish at her school.
Thanks for sharing really those moving stories about the work you do with the most vulnerable children in our communities. Jumping ahead 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, talk about the work you do to help working age residents from Illinois.
Thanks, Ryan. Kate? So the transition of youth into adulthood is a great place for me to share about our records relief work. So criminal records and contact with the police, even when it happened when someone was a child, can follow them into adulthood and really have an impact on their ability to be financially stable and to be independent. So we represent both youth and working age adults who have arrests and convictions to expunge or seal their records. So time and again, research and reports on the topic of records relief shows that expungement and sealing reduces recidivism. It helps to reduce poverty and by removing barriers to employment, to housing, to professional licensure. So this is really about work that gets people back to work. Today, our organization, Legal Aid Chicago, has over 1,100 open criminal records relief cases between our juvenile records team and our adult records team. So our clients with juvenile records, they can be minors that are currently in the midst of the criminal legal system, but they can also be adults, and they often are, and they come to us as adults in direct response to an immediate and a distinct barrier to a goal or objective they have, which is usually about employment, and it's usually about housing. So what happens with our adults that have these lingering juvenile records is they come to us because, you know, they are, you know, for example, we have clients who, a number of them, who have graduated from nursing school, which is a great example. They have graduated, they've passed, but when they go to get their license, they're unable to because of a juvenile record that they may not have known even still existed. So this work in our area has really been strongly supported by LSC, and in particular by the LSC programs that target pro bono partnerships. So we applied for and we received a special grant from LSC to partner with law firms and with corporate legal departments to expunge or seal eligible criminal records in order to disrupt what we've heard of as the school-to-prison pipeline. And these partnerships have just been an absolutely incredible positive relationship for us and results for our clients. So what happens in this partnership is our paralegal will screen clients for eligibility. And then they'll pass it over to our attorneys, who will do a deeper dive to figure out, are the records, are the arrests, and so forth, are they actually eligible for expungement or sealing? Our attorney then will create what's called a case chart, and will pass that over to a pro bono attorney, who will use that information to create the petition necessary to expunge or seal that criminal record. The pro bono attorney will then pass it back over to us, and we will review it, make sure it's good to go, and get it filed in court. So despite really clear eligibility for these types of relief, courts typically do not just grant them. Very often, our attorneys are required to go to court and to litigate and have a hearing and to represent our client in the hearing in order to have their records expunged or sealed. And when that's what's needed, that is what we do. So these can be very full representation cases that would just be impossible to receive support and relief without an attorney. Last year, Legal Aid Chicago partnered with 29 law firms and corporate legal departments to serve clients in this area, and we are on track to do the same or to do more this year. So records relief really is just such an incredible, broad, and sweeping legal remedy that directly contributes to the general legal aid mission of access to justice and access to opportunity. So I'd like to turn it over to Clarissa next.
Thank you, Kate. And records relief is truly transformative in people's lives. I want to talk about another area of law that we all work in, which is helping families when they experience domestic violence. Survivors may need our help to obtain an order of protection, to sever that relationship with that abusive person, and then also to obtain safety and security so they can move on with their lives. So all of us devote a lot of resources to helping domestic violence survivors obtain those orders of protection that puts their abuser away from them, that limits contact, limits harassment, limits the threatening ability, and prevents it from happening. And then we all may help them with broader actions, long-term actions like divorces or child custody matters that also does that. We help these survivors obtain all the remedies they need to move on, including child support and maintenance, sole possession of a home or a car, and in some instances, help them make sure that abuser does not have any access to firearms. Sometimes we help survivors work with their landlords to change the locks, or frankly, to rewrite the lease so their abuser cannot return to the home. Or sometimes, as Kate mentioned, we help them clear their criminal record so they can obtain a job and they can be economically safe, secure, and stable, and independent. We're committed, all of us, to providing holistic legal services to help that individual get to a better place. Helping survivors is one of the biggest ways we collaborate in our communities. In the 65 counties our office serves, we work with over 12 shelters and domestic violence service providers. And we do this not just to help individual clients, but also to address problems we may see with courts or with law enforcement agencies. I want to tell you a little bit more about one of our newest domestic violence collaborations, which I'm very excited about, which means I run the risk of talking way too fast because I get excited, and then I'll be unintelligible. So I'm really going to do my best to tamp down. We've long worked with Quinata, which is a shelter and domestic violence service provider in Quincy, Illinois, on the other side of the state from here. And they serve a 5-county region, but it's roughly 2.5 hours away from our nearest service office. Historically, the way we serve survivors in those communities was by using LSC funds to pay local attorneys to represent our clients. However, the number of private attorneys willing to do this work up there has diminished over the years. And to be very honest, that area that Quinata serves, that 5-county region, is pretty much a legal desert. 3 of the 5 counties that they serve have 10 or fewer attorneys practicing in them. So there aren't even really attorneys to take our cases. Quinata has constantly reminded us of how much they need our help up there, and we have done our best to serve it. Although for a significant period of time, judges up there would not allow us to appear remotely. So in 2022, and sort of a felicitous turn of events, the state of Illinois allocated more money to help domestic violence survivors. And Quinata reached out to us and said, hey, Land of Lincoln, why don't you open a law office with this funding in Quincy? And at the same time, Ascend Justice, which is a Chicago-based nonprofit law firm that helps survivors of gender-based violence, reached out to us. And they said, hey, we know there are rural residents in Illinois who are not getting the support they need when they survive domestic violence. What can we do to help? And our Quincy Legal Partnership was born. So with the help of that funding and also LSC funding, Land of Lincoln opened a law office in Quincy in early 2023. And we worked directly with Quinada to meet the needs of survivors in that 5-county community. Quinada refers clients to us for help in all the areas I've already detailed. But Land of Lincoln doesn't help all the cases that come in. We can't begin to, and we also don't meet the needs of some of those survivors, which is where Ascend Justice comes in. They provide remote legal help to individuals who have immigration cases or other individuals who may need help with family defense representation because DCFS has an open investigation or an open appeal, and they need the help of Ascend Justice. We've all collaborated to train our staff to recognize the legal needs as well as the law. We've trained to come up with a great referral, seamless referral service, so I can contact Ascend if we see a client who needs their help. Similarly, we may reach out to Quinada for additional services for our clients. Our partnership aims to remedy the legal desert for survivors of gender-based violence in that region and provide them with the legal and supportive services they need to survive and thrive. Our leadership is committed. We meet quarterly to troubleshoot, and we're all strongly committed to the vision of ensuring that victims in that particular area, survivors in that area, have access to legal services. I'm going to turn it over to Denise because I know Prairie State also zealously is committed to serving domestic violence survivors.
Yeah, thank you, Clarissa. And the story I would like to highlight on a survivor of domestic violence really focuses on our veterans work. So all three of our organizations with LSC's support focuses on providing civil legal services to our veterans of the United States. And this particular story touches on both our veterans work and our domestic violence work. So Danielle is the individual I will be talking about. She is an ambassador for our work and just a true survivor. At the time she came to us, she was a single mom. She had been in the Army for many years and was currently a member of the Army Reserves in Illinois. And at the time, she was married to her husband. Danielle's husband had been great prior to their marriage, but then once they became married, some abuse started to happen. And once they had their son, the abuse escalated. And that was in April of 2020, of course, right when the pandemic hit. Danielle's husband would not let her leave when they would begin to have an altercation and would often physically restrain her. On one occasion, Danielle tried to leave when they began to have an altercation. He pushed her to the ground, grabbed her neck, choked her, and then stomped on her ribs. Despite that, Danielle did not seek legal help, but continued on. However, when Danielle's husband began to abuse their son, she stepped forward and turned to Prairie State Legal Services for help. So as a first step, we assisted Danielle with an order of protection that covered both Danielle and her son against her husband, which was successfully obtained by the court. And then we represented Danielle in a divorce action for the permanent solution for her family. And then that was successful as well. And Danielle is now doing much better. She works for a private company and has received multiple promotions, including using her Army Supply Specialist training in her work as an inventory associate. She has also completed classes to obtain her real estate license and has passed the national exam. Danielle now lives in a supportive community with her son, who attends a good school in Illinois, and she and her son are now safe and building a happy and productive life here in Illinois. So just another example of the importance of the work to support our survivors of domestic violence and our veterans.
Thanks, Denise. So because domestic violence is such a significant issue for the clients of our three organizations and across the country, I'd also like to share some information about a specific area that we do. And that is an amazing partnership that we've had for 10 years and counting with a private law firm, Denton's, where we are handling appeals for protective orders that have been wrongfully denied in the lower courts or where the courts have made not provided all the remedies that are available. We are so proud of this project and the truly incredible results that we've been able to achieve through it. So basically what happens is when a survivor of violence has been denied an order of protection, we assess the case to determine that it has merit. And if we make that assessment, we pass it over to the firm, Denton's, and they will obtain the transcript and they'll write the appeal with our support. So this collaboration has a near 100% success rate, either in overturning the lower court's ruling or in the lower court changing its mind and making the decision that is right and protects the survivor. It has resulted in published opinions that have been cited not only in Illinois, but across the country. So it is really having an impact on protecting and providing guidance for survivors of domestic violence broadly. So in a recent published opinion, our client had an abuser who was trained in mixed martial arts fighting. He had a long history of very serious physical abuse of our client. And what happened in the recent incident was he punched her in the head, resulting in her having to go to the hospital. He also used his training to take his arm and subdue and to choke her. When she sought an order of protection, she was denied. And we appealed this case because the lower court denied the order of protection because they said she had instigated the abuse by pouring water on him. So in essence, it was her fault. So in their published decision, the appellate court got it right, thankfully, and ruled that the prior history of abuse needs to be considered. It vindicated that survivors are not responsible for their own abuse, and it provided guidance to courts going forward on how to correctly interpret the law.
Thank you, Kate. Our last segment, obviously one that I have a particular interest in, we want to talk about our senior population. What do legal aid lifelines look for legal aid in Illinois? Clarissa?
Yeah, well, Ron, I know you're a happy grandparent, and I imagine that's because you only have to visit them. But I'm not sure if you're aware of this. I'm speaking as a mother of a 10-year-old and a 12-year-old, and sometimes I'd like to just visit them. But I'm not sure if you're aware of this, but there are more than 2.3 million grandparents out there who are raising their grandchildren. And half of those households are low income. There are really all sorts of reasons for this. Some of these children, their parents are dead. The COVID epidemic made 140,000 orphans out there, and grandparents had to step in. Substance abuse by parents is another really big reason. The opioid epidemic has forced a lot of grandparents to step in and take care of their grandchildren because parents can't parent sometimes while they're addicted to drugs or they may be incarcerated. And grandparents have to step in every way, emotionally, financially, and legally. Grandparents find that they need to get a legal guardianship of a grandchild to enroll them in school or maybe take that kid to the doctor and make medical decisions. So Land of Lincoln, as well as Legal Aid Chicago and Prairie State, we all help grandparents obtain guardianships. One grandparent we helped is a woman I'm going to call Marie, who had been raising her granddaughter, who I'm going to call Jessica, since birth. Jessica had cerebral palsy and needed a trach for breathing. She had received health benefits from the state of Illinois since birth. And what those benefits entitled Jessica to was in-home nursing help with her daily care. It allowed her to remain in her home and not be hospitalized. As Jessica approached 17, the state cut the hours of care that she was entitled to from 90 hours to 55 hours. And so her grandma, Marie, had to step in. Grandma Marie was watching Jessica and helping Jessica for 16 hours a day, including she wouldn't sleep at night. She would monitor Jessica because if her trach got clogged, she would lose air and could die in a matter of minutes. So Marie finally called Land of Lincoln, and she was exhausted and frazzled and frustrated. We immediately helped her file an appeal of the state's decision to cut the in-home care hours for Jessica. And while that appeal was pending, Jessica turned 18 and the minor guardianship of her expired. So we helped Marie get an adult guardianship of Jessica so she could continue to be in her life and help her make decisions. I regret to inform you, the appeal was denied at the administrative agency. So we appealed it to circuit court, where we won. And after 2 years of this pending, Jessica finally received a reinstatement of 90 hours of in-home care weekly, and Marie no longer had to spend 16-hour shifts taking care of her granddaughter. As a result, Jessica continues to live in her grandmother's home with a family who loves her and cares for her, and Marie can really be the best caretaker she can be because she's not having to work 16-hour shifts and be exhausted. So, Denise, I'm going to turn it over to you because I know you, too, do a lot of work for seniors, and I was hoping you could tell us a little bit more about it.
Yes, definitely. And the story I'd like to highlight really relates to public benefits work. So we had talked about it in the introduction that generally our work can be divided into three categories: safety, housing, and public benefits. And public benefits for our senior population can address some of the issues our most vulnerable are facing in civil legal aid. These can be wrongful denials of all kinds of different public benefits that exist. It might be Social Security, disability, Medicare, Medicaid. It might be Illinois Department of Human Service basic benefits, whether that's the old food stamp, SNAP benefits, or other cash assistance that are all current programs and that folks are eligible for but are being wrongfully denied. So the story I'd like to highlight is a client. I'm going to call her Esther. She came to Prairie State at 67 years old. Esther's story was that she came to the United States when she was 2 years old through an adoption. She was born in a different country, came to the United States, was adopted by U.S. citizens here, and they helped her naturalize at that point. So Esther became a U.S. citizen when she was 2 years old. Then fast forward through her many years of life, she worked many jobs, paid into the Social Security Administration retirement program. She then, at retirement age, applied for her Social Security retirement benefits, and the Social Security Administration denied her. And she appealed that, and it was denied, and really could not move forward with that appeal process. So she turned to Prairie State Legal Services at that point. Prairie State attorneys then investigated what was going on and why she was not being approved for her Social Security retirement benefits, and determined that the issue was the Social Security Administration did not have her identity accurately on file. Through multiple name changes that she experienced, first with coming to the United States and then being naturalized, then getting married, and then getting divorced, the records just did not all line up, and therefore the Social Security Administration was denying her based on the records they had. Prairie State attorneys then pulled together all the necessary documents and advocated for Esther both to the Social Security Administration as well as to the U.S. Department of Homeland Security and got it all figured out. And the Social Security Administration then approved Esther for her Social Security retirement benefits. And at that point, she was also entitled to an approximate $25,000 back benefit for payments that she was owed that she hadn't received in the past. And it was just such a blessing for Esther, who came to us quite destitute, without options, and now is in a space of financial stability based on benefits through the Social Security Administration that she was entitled to. So really appreciate that work in the public benefits realm to help a lot of seniors who are legitimately eligible for their public benefit but are receiving barriers that they just can't push through. Another area that we serve a lot of seniors is in our housing area, and I'd like to turn that over to Kate.
Thanks. So yeah, housing, as we mentioned, I think probably all of our programs at the outset, this is an area of massive, massive need, both in Illinois and across the country. So we could not talk about our work without including a discussion about our work in the area of housing. So safe and affordable housing is truly the bedrock of family stability. And in Cook County alone, there are over 30,000 evictions filed every year. So we are back up to pre-pandemic levels, and it is rising. Legal Aid Chicago helps to preserve family housing, family stability in two main ways. So one is we represent tenants who are facing wrongful eviction, and we focus on tenants who live in public housing or who have subsidies that allow them to rent in the private market. We also represent homeowners who are facing the loss of their family home, which we know is the equity in those homes that is key to building generational wealth. And we represent them when they are facing a mortgage or a tax foreclosure, in quiet title cases, and in other consumer fraud cases. So I'd like to share examples of two seniors that we represented in these areas. So first, we represented a 70-year-old woman. She owned a three-flat, and it was on the south side of Chicago. She lived in the top floor, and then she rented out the middle and the bottom floor to tenants, both of whom paid their rent via a Section 8 voucher. So the middle tenant was a mom with young kids. The tenant on the first floor was an older woman who was approaching retirement. All three were in danger of losing their home. Our client had purchased the home at the height of the market, and at the time that she purchased the home, she was married, and she had her husband's income as well as her own to pay the mortgage. She then got a divorce, and her husband's income was out of the picture. And even despite the Social Security benefits that she had, her pension, and the rental income, it wasn't enough for her to keep current on the mortgage, and she fell behind. So my colleagues were able to file a creative bankruptcy for her, which enabled her to keep her home, brought her mortgage down from $400,000 to $50,000, enabled her to pay off her mortgage in its entirety so that she could live free and clear and without risk of losing her home. And this work not only preserved her home, but it also preserved the home of her two other tenants. Because it is really difficult to find landlords who are willing to rent to tenants who are paying and using vouchers to pay their rent. And so by keeping them in that home, a home that was safe, that was stable, and in a really peaceful place, like they had developed their own community together in this home. They were all able to stay together. And it was just an incredible, incredible outcome for those three families. So talking about tenants, I mentioned earlier, we focus on tenants who live, preserving the tenancy of tenants who live in subsidized housing, public housing. And the reason that we do that is because the stakes are so high for tenants who are in public or otherwise subsidized housing, because they truly do risk homelessness if they're evicted. If they're evicted, they have no right to return to that subsidized housing. And because their income is so low in the first place to even qualify them for that type of housing, it is unlikely that they would be able to afford to rent on the private market. So truly, the loss of that subsidy just brings them one step closer to sleeping on a couch, on a floor, in a car, or to sleeping on the street. So we really do focus on those areas. And just 2 weeks ago, we were able to save the tenancy of an 89-year-old woman with disabilities who had been living in her apartment since basically LSC started. Nearly 50 years she had been in her same apartment. And for the last 15 years, she had been paying her rent through a subsidy. Now, her landlord, 5 years ago, had started charging her extra, requiring her to pay more on top of that subsidy, which is something that is not allowed under the program. When our client found out about this, that she didn't have to pay, she stopped paying. And when she stopped paying, the landlord retaliated by filing an eviction against her. So we came in. We were able to leverage this illegal overcharge in order to convince the landlord to withdraw the eviction, to seal the record, and to enter into a new lease with our client. Totally incredible.
Clarissa, Denise, Kate, thank you so much for being here today.